Second of all, this is a very ambitious assignment I have this morning. I'm summarizing my 400-page book. And that wasn't a joke. That makes it perhaps even less funny or more funny. I don't know which. But actually, what I'm doing this morning, this is a sermon I gave first as for Missions Week at College Church, where Kent Hughes was in College Church back around 2002. So this actually precedes the book, but it is the book is an expansion of this, which is an expansion of a three-page excursus at the end of my chapter 21 discussion and my Revelation commentary. So it's expanded, and that's part of the main theme of today, is the notion of temple expansion. So hang on to your hermeneutical saddle, because we're going to be riding fast and we're going to be riding hard. I suppose my approach in this particular address is like buckshot. If 60% of it hits you, I'll be satisfied. Tomorrow we're going to just look at Isaiah 6. So, you know, we're going to look at the micro text tomorrow. Today we're looking at the whole Bible, Genesis to Revelation. So I better not have any more introductory comments. I would like to leave about 10 minutes for discussion, and then perhaps there could be more this afternoon at various points. If you leave open your Bible, we'll be looking at Revelation 21, but also Genesis 1 and 2 as well. Now, there's a problem here in the text that was read in Revelation 21. Why does John see a new heavens and earth in verse 1? I saw a new heaven and an earth. First heaven and earth passed away, and there's no longer any sea. Why does he see a new heavens and earth in verse 1, but you read the rest of this vision in chapter 21:1 all the way to 22:5, and there's not a description of the many forests and undulating valleys and the hills and the seas? It doesn't look like the kind of new creation that you and I might describe if we thought we were seeing a new creation. What he sees is a city in the shape of the Holy of Holies, the essence of the temple, that's garden-like. And this is a little bit difficult, because I don't think... Now, it's possible he sees the new heavens and earth, and then in the new heavens and earth he sees a city, and in the city he sees a temple and a garden. But I don't think that's the image as I'm going to try to present to you. I think he sees this new heavens and earth, and then he equates it with a city that's cubic, like the Holy of Holies, and is garden-like. For example, note as the description goes on, even in verse 3, I heard a loud voice from the heaven saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is among men." So all of a sudden it's a tabernacle. Many of the dimensions likewise are found from the book of Ezekiel. Even that statement in verse 3, where it says he'll dwell among them, they'll be his peoples, God himself will be among them, is from Ezekiel 37:27, anticipating that great vision of Ezekiel 40-48, of the city that whose main characteristic is the temple. For example, if you look in 21:10, he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me the holy city. That's exactly what happens to Ezekiel in Ezekiel 40 and verse 2. And in verse 11, this city, the Jerusalem, has the glory of God that comes out of Ezekiel 43, 2, where God's glory shows on the temple. And in verse 12, this city had a great and high wall with 12 gates. Likewise, Ezekiel 48, 31-34 has the 12 gates around the city, in the middle of which is the temple. The precious stones that were read in the scripture reading this morning in verses 18 to 20 is found and actually reflects the description of the foundation of Solomon's temple. In chapter 6 of 1 Kings, verses 20-22, 5:17, and chapter 7, 9-10 of 1 Kings. Did you notice the dimensions of this city, by the way? Look at verse 16. The city's laid out as a square, its length is as great as the width, and he measured the city with a rod, 1,500 miles. Its length and width and height are equal. That is a direct allusion to 1 Kings 6:20, where, quote, the length and the width and the height, in quotation, of the Holy of Holies was equal in measurement. So the city is the Holy of Holies. So Revelation 21:10, in fact, this whole vision in 21 up to the beginning of 22 is describing a city in the shape of the Holy of Holies that is garden-like. And I don't think it's just found within this big new creation. It is equated with it. Well, how would one demonstrate that? Well, first of all, look at verses 1 to 3. I saw a new heaven and earth, for the first heaven and the first earth passed away. There's no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, made ready as a bride, adorned for her husband. And then verse 3, that's what he sees. Verse 3 is what he hears. Heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is among men. He'll dwell among them. They'll be his peoples. God himself shall be among them. I think that verse 3 is probably the interpretation of the new heavens and earth in verse 1 and the new Jerusalem in verse 2. Why do I think that? Because it is an interpretative pattern in the book of Revelation, that you will see a vision and then either a prayer or an acclamation will be given to interpret it. Now, sometimes you'll even get a statement and then a vision will interpret that statement. You remember the classic example, and we could have many examples. We could have our whole time going over that particular interpretative pattern in the book of Revelation. But remember chapter 5, where John hears the lion from the tribe of Judah has overcome so he can open the book. And then all of a sudden, the scene shifts, doesn't it, in the next verse. And I saw a lamb standing as having been slain. And so what's going on there? He hears about a lion. But the way that Jesus has begun to fulfill the great military lion prophecies of the Messiah of the Old Testament, like Isaiah or Genesis 49, 9 through 10, is first through suffering, through veiled kingship, and then resurrection, which of course really is still only at that point for the eyes of those who believe by God's grace. And of course it'll be at the consummation when he will indeed visibly overthrow the kingdoms of evil and set his kingdom up. And so how does he accomplish those apparently military prophecies? Through suffering like a lamb. The lamb's the interpretation by vision of what he has heard about the lion overcoming. So likewise, in 21, 1 and 2, we have a new creation in a city. What does it mean? Behold, I heard. I heard the meaning of it. But some might say, well, maybe that interpretative pattern doesn't hold up every time. All things are possible. But not all things are probable. I think if we can establish the pattern, then if there's some other good reason not to hold to the pattern here, fine, but it would seem to hold. But let me go further. Notice chapter 21 and verse 8. But for the cowardly and unbelieving and abominable and murderers, immoral persons, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their part will be in the lake that burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. So where are the unbelieving? They're in the lake of fire, the second death. And verse 27 of chapter 21 says, nothing unclean will enter this city temple that's garden-like. No one who practices abomination, lying. By the way, it's the same group of people mentioned in verse 8. And they will not come into it, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Now look at chapter 22 and verses 14 to 15. I think there's a little ring with a microphone here. I don't know if we can get that ring out, but if it doesn't bother you, it doesn't bother me. Verse 9, he said to me, well, actually, verse 14, blessed are those who wash their robes that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter by the gates into the city. Now, who doesn't go into the city? Verse 15, outside are the dogs and sorcerers. And by the way, this list again, the same list, it's referring back to 21:8. 21, 27, same list, essentially. Outside of the dogs and the sorcerers, the immoral persons, the murderers and idolaters, and everyone who loves and practices lying. So in the city is the redeemed. Now, do we have the lake of fire in the new creation, but it's just outside the city? There are some idiosyncratic commentators who think that, but I think it's highly, highly improbable. I think what we have here is that outside of the new creation, which is the city temple, are those who are the unbelievers in the lake a fire? How can you have the like a fire in the new creation? That's pretty difficult. So I think this is the telltale sign that John is. He's not just saying, new creation, I saw it. Hey, guess what was in it in a particular place? Well, you know, we can go to the Middle East. There's Jerusalem. There's a temple in it and a garden. No, it's equated with it. I don't know how many of you used to watch Star Trek. You know, we got the Trekkies. You remember the planet of the cyborgs? It's just this square planet, and it was a city. And that's sort of the vision here. A square planet that is a city, and yet it's garden-like. It's got trees and plants growing out of it as well. That is the image. So we're not talking about so much a literal image, but something that is a picture that has a literal meaning, as we'll see. So I think what we have then is a very difficult issue. Why does John, or why is it presented to John in the vision that the new heavens and earth is a city in the shape of the Holy of Holies, its garden light? That puzzled me, but I was convinced of one thing. Not only is the book of Revelation filled with allusions, sometimes two or three in one verse, but this chapter especially is a paramount example of a passage saturated with Old Testament allusions, so I thought, the answer's got to be in the Old Testament. Now, of course, that assumes that the Bible is a unity. Not all assume that, but I think a high view of Scripture would rightly assume that and work on that basis. So I said, there are some references here to Ezekiel and Genesis. Let's go back to Genesis. So that's what we'll do this morning. Come to Genesis with me. And my first point would be that the Garden of Eden was a temple in the first creation. Now, there's some people that we're already at another hard point here. I'm going to explain one difficult passage in Revelation 21 by trying to show that the Garden of Eden was a temple. Doesn't look like a temple. There's no structure there. So how in the world am I going to try to contend that? Thankfully, I'm not alone in this. Some of you know the name of Gordon Wenham, evangelical Old Testament fellow and scholar, and he holds the same view before I did, and I built upon it. But if we can perceive as the Garden of Eden as the first garden-like temple, it will go a long way to helping us come back to Revelation and explain this apparently bizarre picture. But you know what? You know what I find again and again? When you go to the Old Testament, analyze it in depth, and you go to the New, where commentators will say, oh, it's bizarre. This New Testament writer just completely twisted it out of context, was grabbing for all the interpretative gusto he could and got carried away. No, I'm finding again and again, a careful in-depth study of the Old Testament, once you get to the New, not quite so surprising. Though there's some surprise. Why is that? Because of progressive revelation. Well, let's look at this then. These are some reasons that I think that the Garden of Eden was the first temple. I'm going to try to demonstrate that, and then we're going to try to say, as my wife always says, so what difference does it make? First of all, the garden as the unique place of God's presence. The temple later in the Old Testament was the unique place of God's presence, wasn't it? That's where Israel had to go to experience God's presence, especially the priest representing the people. Moses had to go into the tabernacle. Remember, the temple is but the concretization of that tabernacle that was movable, then becomes stable with the architectural temple. So also the Garden of Eden is the place where Adam and Eve can experience God's presence and hear God speak. In fact, remember Genesis 3:8 where it says God's walking back and forth in the garden? For those of you who might know Hebrew, the same Hebrew verb and indeed the same verb form, the hithpael, is used in Genesis 3:8 for God walking back and forth in the garden. It's used elsewhere of priests walking in the temple, or of God walking in the temple. Leviticus 26:12, Deuteronomy 23:14 or 15, depending on versification. 2 Samuel 7, 6-7, Ezekiel 28, 15. I'm not going to try to demonstrate that particular point, but I mentioned the passages. By the way, I did miss, some of you are so diligent. There was a passage up here from Daniel 3 yesterday. A couple of people said, I looked that up, and that's got to be wrong. And it is in the Masoretic text or our English Bibles, but it comes from, there are two versions of Daniel in the Old Testament Greek version. One is the Septuagint, one is Theodotion, and the other version is known as the Old Greek. And this is from the Old Greek where there's a big expansion. It kind of outdoes the Living Bible, and it adds a lot. it adds a lot of verses. Now, I don't want to sound pejorative about the Living Bible. I contributed as a translator to the Living Bible, and the New Living Translation, I think, is a better translation than the original Living Bible. Having said that, Kenneth Taylor did an amazing job to even do that first work, but I must proceed on with our talk here. Secondly, the garden as the place of the first priest. Now, by the way, none of these things that I'm talking about necessarily stand completely on their own. But when you put them all together, I think it is the straw that becomes so heavy it breaks the camel's back and makes the camel cry temple. Adam was the first priest in human history. Say, really? Where are the robes? Where are the sacrifices? Genesis 2:15 says, God placed Adam in the garden to cultivate it and to keep it. To dress it and to keep it or to guard it. These two Hebrew words for cultivate or dress and keep or guard, abad and shamer, are found 10 other times together in the Hebrew Old Testament. And without exception, they refer to Israelites worshiping. The word cultivate is translated serving and obeying God. The second word is obeying. Five times it's used of priests, serving God in the temple and guarding it from unclean things. Some commentators like Umberto Casuto, John Salehammer, and some others, in fact, translate chapter 2 and verse 15 as Adam was put into the garden for serving and guarding. I personally think that this idea of serving is involved, but I still think it has the idea of cultivation. But if Adam is a priest, and if this really is a temple, then even his cultivating activity is a priestly activity, an act of worship, and it fits in with the unique combination of this these two words elsewhere, where there are words of worship and even words that define and describe the priest's activities. What am I trying to do here? I'm trying to let Scripture interpret Scripture here. In fact, Ezekiel 28:12-13 is an amazing text because some think that it describes Satan in the Garden of Eden in Ezekiel 28. I think rather it describes Adam, and I'd be happy in the discussion to talk about that if you want me to. But notice, if this is describing Adam, and by the way, the whole point is to see behind the king of Tyre the first human. We're comparing a human, I don't think, to a demonic angelic being, but to the first human who sinned and committed idolatry. That's verses 1 through 10. Then we go to Adam behind the king of Tyre. Notice in verse 13, you were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering, the ruby, the topaz, the diamond, the beryl, onyx, jasper, lapis, lazuli, turquoise, emerald, the gold, workmanship of your settings and sockets was in you. On the day that you were created, they were prepared. Guess where that list is found uniquely only elsewhere in the Old Testament? Anybody know? It's found in the book of Exodus, describing the priest's jewels on the vest, the breastplate. And I think that this is... Judaism had a tradition that the priest ultimately inherited the position of Adam's priesthood. Some say that's wild and crazy. Sometimes Jewish interpretations in early and late Judaism seem rather bizarre, but I think this is one that is like commentaries you read today. I think there's some truth there. So it appears then that Adam... There are certain things about Adam that point to him being a priest. Secondly, the garden is the place of the first guarding cherubim. When Adam fails to guard the garden, or to the temple by sinning and letting in an unclean serpent to defile the temple, Adam loses his priestly role. And the two cherubim take over the responsibility of guarding the garden. Look at 3:24 of Genesis. The same word for guard is used there. So God drove the man out east of the Garden of Eden. He stationed the cherubim and the flaming sword, which turned in every direction, to Shamir, to guard the way to the tree of life. That's the word used, the second word in Genesis 2:15. Later, Israel's priests were to guard, that same word, they were to guard the temple. Listen to the language of Nehemiah 11:9, 2 Chronicles 23:19. The priests were to guard at the gates of the temple so that no one should enter who was unclean, in quotation. They were, quote, gatekeepers. You've got a gate here, really, don't you? At the end of Genesis chapter 3. Guard the way to the tree of life. In fact, the biblical text, for example, in Nehemiah 12:45, refers to the priests as wardens. You know, in America, we warden is only warden of a prison. And when I went to Tyndale House, we had a warden of the Tyndale House. And I couldn't. So what am I getting into here? But they're managers. And they're managers, and this is the language here. Adam was a manager. He was a guardian of the temple. Now, the role of these cherubim, I think, became memorialized in Israel's temple with the two angelic beings around the Ark of the Covenant. Fourthly, the garden is the place of the first arboreal lampstand, a lampstand like a tree. The tree of life itself was probably... Again, I'm not alone in this. That doesn't mean I'm right, but at least there are others who believe that the tree of life was the model for the lampstand placed directly outside the Holy of Holies in Israel's temple. The temple lampstand looked like a small tree. It had a trunk going up with three protruding branches on either side, and then one going up from the trunk. And again, Exodus 25 31 to 36 describes this lampstand as a tree. Fifthly, that the Garden of Eden was also a temple is evident from this notion that the garden was formative for the garden-like imagery in the temple of Israel. You ever notice that? There's a lot of garden imagery. Why is that? Well, I think it's because it's a reflection of Eden, actually. But you can let both of them interpret one another. When you see this garden imagery in a temple, it suggests that, hey, maybe Eden was not just a garden, but it was a temple. Listen to 1 Kings 6, 18 and 29. It says that in Solomon's temple, quote, cedar carved in the shape of gourds and open flowers, in quotation, was there. In verses 29 to 35, quote, on the walls of the temple roundabout and on the wood doors of the inner sanctuary were carvings of cherubim, palm trees, and open flowers. In 1 Kings 7, 18 to 20, beneath the heads of the two pillars placed at the entrance of the holy place were, quote, carved pomegranates. Why so much fruitful floral depictions? I think it's to recall Eden and suggest that indeed Eden itself was pointing to the Israelite temple. Furthermore, the garden is the first source of water associated with precious stones. It's the first place on a mountain and the first place with an eastern entrance. Just as Israel's later temples and her end-time temple were to be on a mountain, Zion, Exodus 15, 7, and then, of course, the end-time temple in Ezekiel 40 to 48 was to be on a mountain, and they were all to face east, and water was to flow out from them, so Eden is on a mountain, according to Ezekiel 28. And we'll read that in a moment. Talks about this figure who has these jewels that we read about is on the mountain in Eden. Very clear. And furthermore, it faced east, didn't it? Eden faced east, as we can see in chapter 3, verse 24. And water flowed out from it, Genesis chapter 2 and verse 10. Water flowed out of Eden. The idea of precious stones is associated with Eden. In verse 11, speaking about water flowing out of Eden, dividing into rivers. And one river is Pishon. It flows around the whole land of Havilah, where there's gold. The gold of that land is gold, the bdellium and the onyx stone. There's the association of Eden with precious stones. Perhaps we can even say that the garden is the first place of wisdom. The Ark and the Holy of Holies contain the two tables of the law, the epitome of wisdom according to the book of Proverbs and elsewhere in the Old Testament. It represented wisdom. Perhaps this echoed the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, which is closely associated with being wise in Genesis 2 and 3. The touching of both the Ark and of this tree in Eden led to death. Likewise, it's very interesting. I hadn't noticed this, but there is a tripartite structure in Eden, just as we'll see in the temple. Remember, Holy of Holies in Israel's temple, and then you have the outer court where the priest could be, at the holy place, and then the outer court where all Israelites could come. It was in three sections. And so Eden, notice that Eden is divided into at least two sectors. Look again with me at verse 10. Now, a river flowed out of Eden, Genesis 2:10, to water the garden. From there it divided and became four rivers. So you see, the garden technically is not Eden. It's often called the Garden of Eden because of its close approximation. But actually, Eden is the source of the waters. The garden is then watered by it. And then you have the outer inhospitable parts, which is, I'm going to contend, and of course, I think most would agree, humanity was to go out and inhabit that outer area. So you have three areas in Eden, just as there are three sections of the temple. But some would say, okay, Beale, these are cumulative arguments. I mean, everyone is tantalizing. I would contend, you know, if it tastes like a temple and it smells like a temple and it feels like a temple, then let's live by faith and see it as a temple, even if we doesn't look like a typical temple. But I don't have to depend on all these cumulative arguments. Let's go back to Ezekiel 28 again. Ezekiel 28. Notice verse 14, speaking of the anointed cherub who covers. And by the way, I think that cherub is Adam, because then the cherubs take over his role. When it says, you were the anointed cherub, I take that as a metaphor. You're like the cherub, just like it says, God is a shepherd. You are a cherub. Okay. And I placed you there on the holy mountain of God. There it is. It's a mountain of God. But so what difference does that make? Look at verse 18. By the multitude of your iniquities and the unrighteousness of your trade, you profaned your sanctuaries. There are sanctuaries in Eden. And in fact, that plural phrase, sanctuaries, is used not untypically in the Old Testament to describe the one temple of Israel. Why? Because there are little sanctuaries in it. We've already seen three, Holy of Holies, Holy Place, and the courtyard. And even in the Holy Place, there are all these little rooms. So sometimes it would be defined as the plural sanctuaries. So here we have an explicit reference to Adam, to this Eden being sanctuaries. And it's interesting that even in early Judaism, again, some ask me, why do you refer to Judaism in your writings? Because it's not inspired literature. In fact, sometimes I get real excited. I'll get excited occasionally in my study. My wife's office is downstairs with mine. And actually, I'm a little charismatic in the study. I'll go, oh, my gosh, this is amazing. My wife will open the door and say, oh, what's going on? And I say, oh, listen to what I just found. I'll read it. And the first time I did that, she said, where is that in the Bible? I said, well, that's from Judaism. She went. She said, I'll open the door again when you give me something from the Bible. But I want to ask you, have you found some commentaries, modern commentaries on the Bible that are helpful? I think everyone would say we found some things that were helpful and some things that weren't. Well, let's push our commentaries back 2,000 years. there were interpreters who lived closer to oral biblical tradition. Biblical tradition, oral tradition that arose in Bible times that probably have dissipated like an early morning breath by now. But there are some things, I think, that Jewish interpreters saw that are helpful. And my argument isn't based on Jewish interpreters, just as no argument should be based on a modern commentator. But what the commentator says ought to open our eyes to what's in the text. And so likewise, listen to what the Book of Jubilees from 160 B.C. says. Quote, Noah knew that the Garden of Eden was the Holy of Holies and the dwelling of the Lord. And Mount Sinai was in the midst of the desert, and Mount Zion was in the midst of the navel of the earth. These three were created as holy places. So this is not an unusual view. It has early attestation. But not only was Adam to guard this sanctuary, he was to subdue the earth according to Genesis 1:28. Let's look at that text again. It's a very important text, as we're going to see in a few moments. Genesis 1:28. In fact, I call this the Great Commission. Matthew 28 is the 80th commission. I hope that doesn't offend anybody, but I believe that in fact what we have in Matthew, as if we have time, I'll talk about this in Matthew. I think that Matthew is a regurgitation, that is a reapplication, indeed, even of Genesis 1:28. We find evangelism and missions in Genesis 1:28, in my view. In 1:28, then God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the sky and over every living thing that moves on the earth. So they are to subdue, to multiply, and to fill the earth. But how does this relate to Adam in Eden in Genesis 2? I think that's the first place in Genesis 2 in this garden temple that Adam was to begin to fulfill Genesis 1:28. As a priest, he was to keep unclean things out. A serpent comes in. Of course, we know he doesn't keep him out. He lets him have full reign in the house of God, in the temple. But he was to subdue the serpent, the garden, subdue the serpent. And from there on, subdue the earth. And so I think that actually this idea of Genesis 2:15, of beginning to cultivate and beginning to guard and really subdue is a beginning attempt to exercise the fulfillment of Genesis 1:28. And in fact, this idea of being in the image of God, you'll notice that, of course, God blesses them, puts them in a position of favor above the rest of the creation as a crown of creation. They are to be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth. And subdue the earth. This idea of filling the earth is not just filling it with culture makers. It is. But I think a lot of commentators, especially Reformed commentators and theologians, focus on a cultural mandate. While that is not wrong, there's more to it. This earth is to be filled with image bearers. Image bearers. To fill it with the glory of God. And if you read Psalm 8, the most explicit commentary on Genesis 1, 26 to 28, it begins and ends with the glory of God. And that Adam was to achieve that glory, ultimately as an image bearer. We're to go out and fill the earth with God's glory in everything that we do. Whatever our calling is, whether it's to be a minister or an elder or a member of a church who's an electrician, whatever, we're to fill the earth with the glory of God. And in fact, temples have images in them, especially the pagan temples. This temple had the true image. Humans distort the image of God when they make images and worship them, because they're to be the image of God, to reflect God. And Adam was that image as God places him into the first garden temple. So as Adam was to begin to rule, to rule over, subdue the earth, extend, I think, he was... Part of that ruling and subduing was to extend the geographical boundaries of the garden temple where God's presence was, to expand the presence of God. That is, as he produces progeny who bear the image of God, you have a lot of children, you've got to add on to your house. And he would begin to do that with his progeny, and they would begin to extend the Garden of Eden out into the earth to cover the earth. In this regard, I think that we can see that Adam's management in the garden then was guarding it from the threat of unclean things entering it to corrupt it. Would not this management also include Adam teaching God's law from Genesis 2:16 to 17, keeping it in mind? As we'll see later, they didn't do a very good job of that. And the picture then is Adam as a kind of warden, managing a sacred ward, a temple. As the first couple had children, it's plausible to suggest then that the management of the garden extended to teaching his children God's law and by serving God, by obeying it. John Walton, who's a colleague of mine at Wheaton, has said this in his commentary on Genesis, quote, "If people were going to fill the earth, according to Genesis 1, we must conclude that they were not intended to stay in the garden in a static situation. Yet moving out of the garden would appear a hardship, since the land outside the garden was not as hospitable as that inside. Otherwise, the garden would not be distinguishable from that which is outside. Perhaps then we should surmise that people were gradually supposed to extend the garden as they went about, subduing and ruling. Extending the garden would extend the food supply as well as the sacred space of the temple." Other commentators have held to this. The main one I have in mind is Meredith Klein in his Kingdom Prologue, that there would be an expansion of Eden. But what this means is that I think Adam was to widen the boundaries of the garden in ever-increasing circles by extending the order of the garden of sanctuary into the inhospitable outer spaces, which includes, most of all, spreading the presence of God as image bearers. This would occur especially by Adam's progeny, born in his image and reflecting his image, God's image, and the light of his presence as they went out to subdue the inhospitable outer territory. In fact, that Adam was a son of God, as the end of Luke 3 says, is apparent from the fact, if you remember Genesis 5, 1 to 3, I'm not going to turn to it, but there it repeats Genesis 1, 26, that Adam was made in the image and likeness of God. And then it says, and he bore a son, Seth, in his image and likeness. You see, image and likeness is sonship language. And I think we ought to interpret Genesis 5 by Genesis 1 and vice versa. And that means if Adam's in the image of God, he is a son reflecting God, and so should his children have been sons of God. So, as we know, Adam was not faithful and obedient, so that not only was the garden temple not extended throughout the earth, Adam himself was cast out of the garden and did not enjoy any more God's special revelatory presence. And he lost his function as God's priest in the temple. Now, we could stop right here, which I'm not going to do. But I want to stop here because we're going to continue to do some things, and we're going to go pretty fast. So I want to stop here to make sure that you're going to get two-thirds of my answer to the problem of why is the new heavens and earth in Revelation 21 equated with a temple that a city in the shape of a temple that's garden-like. Now, I hesitate to do this because it will embarrass me, but I've been embarrassed before. I'm going to ask you a question. Why would Revelation 21 equate the new earth with a city, especially in the shape of a temple that's garden-like, in light of what I've said? I'm embarrassed. I'm hoping it's not a rhetorical question that I have to answer.
Could you repeat it?
Yes. Why? Why does Revelation 21 present the new earth, essentially, as a temple that's garden-like? Let's just leave it at that. Now, we'll get to the city later. And the original intention of Adam in the Garden of Eden was to do what?
To extend the temple through the
earth. Until it encompassed the boundaries of the earth so that earth and temple and Eden garden were equal. I see someone going like this. Yes, sir.
How can the Garden of Eden separate from the earth as a whole?
It's not separate, it's equal. That's right. That's right.
Perfect.
Question and answer time, okay? Question and answer time, because it'll throw us off and I won't finish. I'm not putting you off, so please keep that question. So I think so far, if I can answer that question later, We have seen two-thirds of the answer. That finally, we have the achievement of the completed design of what Eden was all about. It was to be extended by an Adam, who ultimately in the book of Revelation and elsewhere is Jesus Christ, who has extended, finally, at the end of time, temple over the whole earth. So that you see, the temple is not an architectural structure. It can be a garden. It can be an architectural structure. As we're going to see in the New Testament, it can be the glorious presence of God dwelling in his people. And finally, it's the new heavens and earth. But I need to go further to explain why. Further, the new heavens and earth is explained as a temple. I think we've gone a long way. But we're going to have to get, why a city? Okay. So let's move on. After Adam's fall and expulsion from the garden temple, mankind became worse and worse, and only a small remnant of the human race were faithful. God eventually destroyed the whole earth by a flood because it becomes so thoroughly wicked. Only Noah and his immediate family were spared. Now, it's just possible there may be some intimation that God began to build a temple at Noah's time. Meredith Klein thinks that the ark was really the continuation of God's special dwelling place. I can talk about that in a question and answer time. I think he may be onto something, but I'm not going to try to demonstrate that. I think it's harder to demonstrate. But if they were involved in some kind of temple building, like Sons of Adam, and this is Genesis 1:28 is applied to Noah very explicitly, more explicitly than anyone else in the whole Bible. Such temple building was not completed, but it was halted because of the disobedience of sin of Adam, of Noah and his children. Now, after the disobedience of Noah and his sons, God, from the human perspective, of course, God's planning this all along, but God starts from a human perspective over again. He chooses Abraham and his descendants, Israel, to reestablish his temple. Now, there's something very interesting about the commission to Abraham in Genesis 12, 1-2. Now, I'm going to contend that Genesis 1:28 is actually woven into the commission to Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, and I'm going to show that in just a moment. It's a beautiful example of how Scripture is using Scripture. But what's interesting is, if that's the case, as I'm going to try to show in 1 second, most commentators, there are a few articles you can find, most commentators have not noticed something very interesting. I think almost a new book of Genesis starts at chapter 12. You read some of the commentaries, and they might have a little parenthesis, compare Genesis 1:28. Now, that's it. And so what does he think about that? But actually, there's a continuity. Abraham is being given the mantle of Adam from Genesis 1:28. It was initially to be carried out by Adam in a localized place, enlarging the borders of the sanctuary. And it appears to be not accidental that the commission here is applied not just to Noah, but to the patriarchs. And we're going to see that commission, whenever 1:28 is applied to the patriarchs, that it's found in sanctuary-like settings. Why would that be? Because it's all a replication of Adam. He receives the commission in the context of a sanctuary. He needs to carry it out in a sanctuary. But first of all, I just do want to point out some of these repetitions. I don't have time to go into them in detail. I have them in my book. But here's the clearest applied to Noah. Be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth. Be fruitful, multiply, populate the earth. But then Genesis 2:12-3. Now, it's not as clear, but I think it's there. It says, I'll make you a great nation. I will bless you. Notice the multiple blessings here. I think it comes out of Genesis 1:28. And the idea of all the earth, here we have all the families of the earth being blessed. But you have to put some of the other Abrahamic promises together with this one, because it comes out also from Genesis 1:28. I will multiply you exceedingly. I will make you exceedingly fruitful. Indeed, I will greatly bless you. You know, Bill, my screen's being cut off here. How do I get down? Because when I punch... Okay, we're just kind of dead then. But we've got... well, I'm doing page down, but then it hits me the next slide on my PowerPoint. At any rate, you find the same kind of thing repeated to Abraham in chapter 22, to Isaac in chapter 26, to Jacob in chapter 28, and again in chapter 35. There it is. I'm not going to go into detail, but many commentators see that this is a reference back to Genesis 1:28. What's interesting about it is, to Adam and to Noah, it's only mandate. When you get to Abraham, it's mandate. In fact, 12:2 says, be a blessing. It's an imperative. But then it's a promise. It's mixed with promise. Maybe it was with Adam because of Genesis 3:15. But that's after the fall. It's not mixed with a promise in 1:28. And so here you get both this tension between you're supposed to do it, and they fail, and yet there's a promise that a seed will do it. Now, what happens is that when you find those references from Genesis 1:28 to the patriarchs, that long list we just looked at, there are six things in the immediate context that are also found that appear only elsewhere in the Bible in connection to the temple. For example, God appears to them. It's a theophany, and so you've got the theophonic presence of God in the temple in 1 Kings 8 and in many other texts in the tabernacle. They pitch a tent. Okay, again, this is all in the context of these repetitions of Genesis 1:28. So just as 1:28 is related to a garden temple, likewise, we have it here. This idea for tent in the LXX is tabernacle in the Hebrew. It's ohel, which can not untypically also refer to the tabernacle or the temple. They're on a mountain. They build altars, the patriarchs do. They worship God. Remember, they call on the name of God. Karah, they cry out in the name of God. At the place of the restatement, the place where these activities occur is, I don't think coincidentally, Bethel, the house of God. The only case of altar building not containing these elements nor linked to the Genesis 1 commission is Genesis 33:20. I think the exception proves the rule. The commission is repeated, and I go into detail about this commission to Abraham. I've already done a little bit of that. For example, in Genesis 28, just to show you another example, where you find early in verses 3 to 4 this repetition of Genesis 1:28, now you get temple language. Jacob goes to a certain place. He spent the night there because the sun had set. He took one of the stones of the place, put it under his head, and laid down in that place. He had a dream. A ladder was set on the earth with its top reaching to heaven, and behold, the angels of God were ascending and descending. In other words, there's a link between heaven and earth, just as there was between the Holy of Holies and earth. There was a direct link. God was seen, and his throne was seen as extending down from heaven to the Holy of Holies. And likewise, he says, if God will be with me and keep me on this journey, I'll return to my father's house. This is a stone which I've set up as a pillar, and it will be God's house. It will be God's house. So this is called Bethel. He now calls this place the house of God. It's the place where heaven intersects with the earth. So what we really have are these different little, what I call it in Coet, or embryonic temple building situations of the patriarchs. Just like Adam's was a little temple building situation, it was to expand. I think all of them point to God's plan of having a bigger temple, in Jerusalem in this case. But we're going to see that even that temple was to expand. And actually, I'm going to contend that the temple was symbolic of the cosmos, of the creation, especially the coming new creation. So even the Israelite temple was going to point to something further, and that's what I want to talk about now. But just to sort of further indicate that these patriarchal situations where Genesis 1:28 is reiterated to the patriarchs by command and promise, and there's a temple atmosphere, look at this narrative later about David in the temple, which has all the same ingredients, which I think shows, letting Scripture interpret Scripture, that they were doing little miniature temple building activities, hoping that it would expand, that was the idea. So we have David's preparations for building the temple that Solomon would accomplish. Notice, David begins the preparations on a mountain. He experiences a theophany between heaven and earth, an angel. At this site, David built an altar to the Lord. He offered burnt sacrifices. He calls out to the Lord, just like the patriarchs. He calls the place the house of God, because this is the site of Israel's future temple to be prepared by David and built by Solomon. Now, here we have Israel's temple. I'm going to probably have to get a better picture, but at any rate, here we have the Holy of Holies. You can kind of make out the seraphim there. Here's the holy place, porch of the holy place, and then the courtyard here. And we'll come now to the next main segment of the message. Israel's tabernacle in the wilderness and later temple was a reestablishment of the Garden of Eden's temple. And for the first time, really, we have repeated, even more explicitly than before, that the dwelling place of God among his people is a tabernacle or a temple. It really hadn't been called temple yet in everything I've talked about, house of God, etc. Various other synonyms, tent. But now we've got it very, very explicit. And it is seen to be a development, as I've already hinted at, of the Garden of Eden, Israel's temple. Why? Why does the temple have so many resonances with Eden? Now, there it just looks like an architectural ancient building. Doesn't look like Eden. We've already talked about the ways that Eden and the temple are so similar. And I think that because Israel was given that Genesis 1:28 commission, passed on from Adam, Noah, onto the patriarchs and Israel, that they're taking the mantle of Adam. They're a corporate Adam. They're now representing true humanity. And this is why Jesus is the last Adam, jumping way ahead, because he's doing what Adam and Israel should have done. They were a corporate Adam. That's why they're called the Son of God in Exodus 4:21 and Hosea 11:1 and a number of other texts in the Old Testament. But there's something true of the Eden temple that I haven't mentioned yet, and it's perhaps a little clear with Israel's temple, and that is that the temple was a model of the heavens and the earth. You say, really?
You could have fooled me.
First of all, Psalm 78:69 says this. It's probably the clearest passage. Says that God built the sanctuary like the heavens. He built the sanctuary like the earth, which he has founded forever. That's amazing. That God, I want to say it again, Psalm 78:69, God has built a sanctuary like the heights. He has built it like the earth, which he founded forever. Even Exodus 25. Says that the tabernacle was to reflect the heavenly tabernacle. So chapter 25 and verse 9, according to all that I'm going to show you, as the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of all its furniture, just so you shall construct it. All I'm going to show you in the end of chapter 25 and verse 40 says, what you were shown on the mountain, that pattern from heaven, you build a tabernacle. So here we have the tabernacle reflecting the heavenly tabernacle. Psalm 78 says it also reflects the earth. Now, we got a problem. Isaiah 66:1, God says, heaven is my throne. You remember this passage. The earth is my footstool. Where then is a house you could build for me? Well, they had built a house. He ordered them to build a house. But he says, really? Can that house contain me? No. See, God never intended that Israel's little localized temple would last forever. Since like the Eden temple and Israel's temple, it was a small model of something which was much bigger. It was a model of God's presence that would fill the heavens and earth. It was a model actually symbolizing the heavens and earth, as I'm going to talk about now, in which God would fill all of the heavens and the earth. It was a miniature model of God's huge cosmic temple, which was to dominate the heavens and the earth. It was a model of the present cosmos, though it was fallen, so it was also a model of that coming new unfallen creation. And that is the case is evident from the following. And I don't have this on the PowerPoint, but I think that hopefully you can follow it. Remember, the temple was divided into three sections. We've got, again, the Holy of Holies, Holy of Holies, Holy Place, the outer courtyard. Now, even though that looks very architectural, and of course it is, we've already seen that there are all kinds of architectural features that reflect Eden, which was part of the primal pre-fall earth. Well, let's take the Holy of Holies. For example, I would contend that the Holy of Holies is a symbol for the invisible dimension of the heaven, the Holy Place, a symbol for the visible heavens, say, really? And then the outer courtyard, a symbol for the earth and the seas. That's very visible. Let's go to the Holy of Holies, first of all. And there are all kinds of books on the temple, and I always put them down because they just seem too allegorical. And so I hope I'm not guilty of allegory. I'm trying to be as restrained as I can be. So here we go. First, that the Holy of Holies represents the invisible heaven where God and his angels dwelt is suggested by the following observations. Just as the angelic cherubim guard God's throne in the heavenly temple, you've got the statues of the cherubim in the Holy of Holies around the ark, probably representing them in heaven. In fact, the figure of the cherubim are even woven into the curtain that separates the Holy of Holies from the holy place. Second, the fact that there's no image of God in the Holy of Holies, that it appeared empty, further points to it representing the invisible heaven that one cannot see. Third, the Holy of Holies was the place where the heavenly dimension, indeed, as I mentioned earlier, extended down to the earth. This is why the Ark of the Covenant is called the footstool of the Lord in various texts. Why? He's seen as sitting on his throne in heaven, his feet extending down to the ottoman of the Ark of the Covenant. It's the place where heaven extends down to earth. It's a special revelatory presence of God. Fourth, the Holy of Holies was cordoned off by a separating curtain that indicates separateness from the holy place and the outside courtyard, perhaps further pointing to the invisible heavenly dimension that's separated from the physical. Fifth, even the high priest would enter only once a year, and even then could not see the presence of God because he had an incense cloud. And perhaps that cloud even pointed to the heavenly clouds that in some texts point to the unseen heaven, just as heaven can mean the visible heaven, but sometimes the unseen heaven. But the holy place, this second part of the temple, right here, represented the visible heavens. You say, really? Well, let me try to demonstrate that. First, the curtains of the holy place were blue, purple, and scarlet, representing the variegated colors of the sky. And the figures of winged creatures are woven throughout these curtains, perhaps enforcing the imagery of winged creatures in the heavens. Second, the lampstand had seven lamps on it. And in Solomon's temple, remember, there were 10 lampstands? So if you looked in to the holy place, not the holy of holies, but the holy place, which is rather dark, but you would see 70 lights in there. Looked like a little mock-up heaven, if you will, with stars in it. Third, this symbolism is enhanced by observing that the Hebrew word for lights here in the plural in English transliteration is me'orot. That word for lights is used 10 times in the Pentateuch for the lamps that are lit up on the lampstand. Can you say, so what difference does that make? Because this word is only used one other time in the Pentateuch. Anybody know where it's used? Some Hebrew people? Even the English word lights. Genesis 1, referring to the sun, the moon, greater, the lesser light, and the other lights, the stars. I think that's more than coincidental. It suggests further the starry symbolism of the lights on the lampstand. In fact, Isaiah 40 says that God stretches, quote, stretches the heavens like a curtain, spreads them out like a tent to dwell in. He has created the host of stars to hang in that tent. Psalm 19, 4-5 says that in heaven, quote, God placed a tent for the sun. But plausibly, this is the reason the holy place was covered all over with gold. So perhaps that the sheen would be seen as that which reflects light, like the stars do as well. It's interesting that some of the early commentators in Judaism, here we go to Judaism again, my wife's not here, Josephus and Philo said that the lights on the lampstand represented the light sources in heaven. And Josephus, actually, who had, he was a Pharisee, and he had looked through the holy place to the curtain, separating the Holy of Holies, said that on that curtain there was needlework of the stars representing the cosmos. And, of course, it's significant that curtain is torn at his death. And I think it represents the old age is beginning to disintegrate, and the new age, the new creation is coming through Jesus Christ. I had a student that just did a dissertation just on the torn curtain in Matthew 27. And it's very, very excellent work. The courtyard here in the outer area is the place, for example, remember there's this large molten washbowl. You have to get to it by a ladder. So it wasn't for daily cleansing, since there were 10 waist-high washbowls in the courtyard for the priests. So it was symbolic, probably, of the sea. The altar is called the bosom of the earth in Ezekiel 43, and it's identified with the mountain of God in Ezekiel 43:16. So this large molten bowl that you can't even get into except by a ladder and the altar are associated with the earth. And very interestingly, the symbolic nature of this bronze sea is indicated by the fact that it, not only was it 7 feet high, couldn't get into it, but there were 12 bulls under it, entirely encircling this bronze bowl called the sea. And there were lily blossoms decorating the brim, probably representing the life on earth around the seas. In fact, the 12 bulls supporting this big sea were divided into groups of three facing to the four points of the compass, which can well reflect the four quadrants of the whole earth. So the cumulative effect of these observations is that Israel's temple served as a little earthly model of God's temple in heaven, which would eventually encompass the whole earth. That's my contention and thesis. That is, in the Holy of Holies, God's Holy of Holies presence here, at some point in the invisible dimension of heaven, would break out at the end of time and begin to cover the starry heavens and the earth and the sea, so that everything would become the Holy of Holies. Which is what we already saw, didn't we? In Eden, Revelation. This is why the latter two sections of the courtyard and the holy place are symbolized in Israel's earthly temple, to show they'll be consumed by God's Holy of Holies presence. Now, some of you have experienced this. I remember I was in a little bitty church in New England for some years, and they were busting at the seams. They had to build a new building. So the church got an architect. He made a little model of the new building. And, the parking lot and the fake bushes. And they put it under a little plastic thing when you walk through the foyer before you got into the sanctuary. You could look at this and think about, how would God lead you to support this expansion? Because no one ever thought, well, maybe they did, but it was quite secondary, that, wow, the person that made that is sure a good model maker. And just left it at that. Now, the point is, this was a model of something that's to be bigger. I think that Israel should have understood the temple to be a model of something much bigger. True, you had to have eyes to see and ears to hear, but that's true with Jesus. That's true with special revelation. And so this represented their mission. And really, if they understood the mission of Adam, to bear God's glorious presence wherever we go, that presence would affect people and they would become part of the temple. And the temple would expand, as we're going to see in the New Testament. It's clear we're not going to have time for questions now, but by God's grace, we've changed the schedule and we're going to have it after lunch. Israel's temple then was a small-scale model and symbolic reminder to Israel of the task God wanted them to carry out. They should have carried it out, but they didn't, as we know. And it's very interesting that even the land of Canaan was called the Garden of Eden. And I think the reason was is because that wasn't a land just to be there by itself. It was to be expanded. There are a number of texts here that I just don't have time to go in to show further expansions of the temple, but one's Jeremiah 3. I'll just mention that one as a part for the whole. It says this, remember it, a time will come when they'll say, no more of the ark of the Lord, no more of the ark of the Lord, for Jerusalem will be God's throne. Well, the idea is this, the Holy of Holies and the ark of the Lord, remember that was part of the throne, that was the ottoman in which God's legs metaphorically were seen to be, his feet were seen to be resting on. That was the throne of the Lord specifically in a special revelatory way. Now, Jeremiah is saying, no more of the ark of the Lord, Jerusalem. The temple will cover Jerusalem. It'll cover the land of Israel according to the end of Ezekiel 37. And the whole earth according to Daniel. Maybe in question and answer I can show you my Daniel slides, because that stone, I think, is the foundation stone of the temple that fills the earth. And it's even an allusion there, filling the earth to Genesis 1:28. But we'll talk more about that if we have the time. Israel didn't carry out this great mandate. They saw the temple as an emblem that they were God's elect, and that all outside of them would be judged. So God sends them into exile, and he starts temple building again. And this time it's through Christ and his followers. Christ is the temple builder according to Zechariah 6. Remember it says the branch will build the temple? It's the messianic branch who will build the temple. He's the temple toward which all earlier temples looked and which they anticipated. He's the epitome of God's presence on earth as God incarnate, thus continuing the true form of the temple, which actually was a foreshadowing of Christ's presence all along. What was the essence of the temple? It was the glorious presence of God. Christ repeatedly refers to himself in the Synoptic Gospels as the cornerstone of the temple. And in John 2:18-21, destroy this temple, in 3 days I'll raise it up. The Jew says it took 46 years to build this temple, and you'll raise it up in 3 days. But John says he was speaking of the temple of his body. By the way, why does Jesus refer to his resurrection as raising up the temple? Because the temple represented the coming new creation. Resurrection is the beginning of new creation. It fits. It's not just, oh, I think I'll give them a little illustration that my resurrection is like the temple. And by the way, Jesus is not just like the temple. And we, as we'll see in a moment, we're not just like the temple. That's an analogical hermeneutic that ironically literal interpreters, when they see that we're the temple of God, or that we're a new creation, or that we're really resurrected people, well, that can't be literally true because that's not physically true. But in fact, spiritual truths are literal. The resurrection begins spiritually in believers and is finished consummately physically. And so we really are. The end time temple began in Jesus and continues in us. And we really are. We need to realize we're not after the New Testament. We're in it, and we're still part of this expanding invisible temple. Temples come in various ways, shapes, and sizes. They can be a structure. They can be a garden. Ezekiel 11 at the end says that God would be a sanctuary for Israel in exile. What'd they do? Get the temple on these big rollers and pull it into exile? No, because it was destroyed. But he was still a sanctuary, a mikdash, it says in Hebrew. And so there are many who think that there will be, according to prophecy, a rebuilding of the temple in Jerusalem. And there's a lot of fervor about this. Some of us here, I speak of us, figuratively speaking, corporately, we may disagree about, is there going to be a temple in Jerusalem rebuilt? Is there not? For myself, I don't think there is. Though I have less of a convicted profile about what's going to happen in the future than I have about what's happened in the past. However, here's why I don't think there's going to be a rebuilding of the temple, and that is because Christ fulfills the foreshadowing of the temple. He fulfills the temple prophecies, as do believers, and once the type is fulfilled, you don't reverse redemptive history. It's something like this. The temple really, Hebrews 9:9 describes the physical temple in the Old Testament. This is interesting. The literal, well, many would say, well, the physical temple, has got to be the only literal temple. And when Christ and believers are called the temple, clearly, figuratively. Well, not if you look at the Old Testament. There true temples come in different shapes and sizes. And it's something, well, Hebrews 9:9 calls the literal physical temple the parabole in Greek. That's where we get the word parable. It's the parabolic, it's the metaphorical temple. And it says Jesus in Hebrews 9 and 10 is the true, the alethenos, the true literal temple. That reverses things, that the physical is not necessarily the literal. Though it will. All the promises of God are yes in Jesus, 2 Corinthians 1, aren't they? And I think all the promises begin spiritually, consummated physically, whether that's resurrection, except, of course, Jesus had his consummate physical resurrection as the first fruits. I think what I'm trying to get at is something like this. I remember when I started graduate school in Cambridge, I just had met Dorinda, who was going to become my wife, but wasn't at that point, and we wrote. We wrote back and forth. Remember my little cell block at Tyndale House, and I would get a letter from her, and I had her picture, but the only picture I had her brother in it. So after reading her letters and looking at the picture, I cut her brother out. I just couldn't lovingly look at Dorinda with her brother looking on. You know. So I look at her picture and read her letters, and then we really got to know each other really well over that year of corresponding. And then 2 weeks later, when I returned to the United States in the summer, we got engaged, and we've been married 31 years, as I said yesterday. And really, you know, if we were in our sitting room at home, and all the time I was just looking only at that picture, and not looking at her and dialoguing with her and hugging her. In fact, I remember maybe I did hug the picture back at Tyndale House. I don't know. I know others have done that sort of thing, and even kissed the picture, you know. I had a colleague who did that kind of thing before he was married. But if I'm hugging and kissing and looking only at the picture and not my wife, I've reversed marital history. I mean, I've gone back to premarital. No. You know, the consummation has come and the marriage and we're to be one. And so I think waiting for a temple to be built is like hugging the picture. When the reality is there, it's right here in Jesus Christ is the true temple. Now, of course, we find, and I know I'm going to have to perform my own eschatological ending here because time is running out. Perhaps permit me five minutes. What time does lunch start, Bill?
Well, it's coffee. It starts about now, but yeah.
Oh, it's 11 now. That's right. It starts now. When we believe in Jesus, we become a part of Jesus and the temple. 1 Corinthians 3, do you not know that you're a temple of God? The Spirit of God dwells in you. So 1 Corinthians 6:19, other texts as well. Christ perfectly obeyed and expanded the boundaries of the temple from himself to others. And here I have a really nice overhead on the Great Commission and how it shot through with temple prophecies. The Great Commission. But maybe I'll have time to show that in the question and answer period. We're lampstands in the temple. So the mystery of how John can see a new heavens and earth in Revelation 21:1, and then in the rest of the vision, he sees only a city in the form of a garden-like temple, I think has been clarified especially by Eden, but also the understanding of the temple in Israel. Revelation 21:1-3, of course, defines the new creation and the city as the tabernacle. And 21:22, remember, says, there was no temple in the new heavens and earth because the Lamb and the Lord God Almighty were the temple. There was a temple. Some think that means there was no temple. No, there wasn't the physical pictorial pointer anymore because the whole heavens and earth had become the temple because the Lamb and God's presence permeated every nook and cranny of the new heavens and the new earth. In terms of why, I think we've talked clearly, well, hopefully it's clear, why the new creation is equal to a temple and a garden, from Genesis 1-3, but why a city? Well, Jeremiah 3 and other texts that maybe I can expand on later, where it says, no more the ark of the Lord because Jerusalem will become the Holy of Holies, the throne of God. And then Jerusalem will spread out to the land of Eden, according to the end of Ezekiel 37, and then the whole earth. So it all has to do with temple expansion. Again, why is the city temple in 21:18 to be pure gold? Because the entire Holy of Holies of Israel's temple was paved with gold. By the way, it's not a tripartite temple in Revelation 21. It's just the Holy of Holies. Why? Because heaven has come down and glory filled my soul. That is, the Holy of Holies has come and it has encompassed the visible heavens and the invisible heavens at the end of times. It starts with us, though, as we believe in Jesus, that he died and rose again for us and sent his Spirit into us. In fact, I have a 60-page, two-part Tyndale article in Tyndale Bulletin arguing that the commencement of the temple for the church, where nowhere does it talk about commencement, it just says we are a temple. I think it's Acts 2, when the Holy Spirit comes down and fills us, though that is a long address in itself. We are priests in that temple. Do we offer sacrifices? Romans 12, 1 and 2, yes, ourselves, as Jesus began to show that sacrifice revolved around him and not the temple. So we follow him as an example, not in a substitutionary way, of course. We sacrifice ourselves for him. We teach and pray as priests. We guard the church and the family of the temple of our family from evil and uncleanness. And we are mediators. And so as we go out through word, through reflecting the image of God as sons of God, we, as people come under the influence through the work of the Spirit that is in us because we're a temple, and as others begin to be created in the image of God, they become part of the temple and they grow. I never understood why Ephesians... The church is to bear fruit as an Edenic sanctuary, grow, extend across the earth in the way God intends, staying out of the shadows of the world, remaining in the light of God's presence. The mark of the true church is a unified and expanding witness to the presence of God. And so I better conclude. Oh, that's an amazing text there. Oh, this is Daniel 2. I can't wait to get to it. Oh, my gosh, Leviticus. Oh, it breaks my heart. Oh, my gosh, there's 2 Chronicles and Matthew. Unbelievable. Take it by faith. I skipped Qumran. My wife will be happy. The main point of this book and address is that our task as a church is to be God's temple so filled with his glorious presence that we expand and fill the earth with that presence, singular, until God finally accomplishes the goal completely at the end of time. This is our common mission. By the way, to let you know about my eschatology, I'm an inaugurated millennialist. That is, the rubric would be amillennial. I'm not a postmillennialist. So I wouldn't see that the building of this temple has a lot of physical accoutrements that'll pass through the fires. It's an invisible temple that's being built. It's that invisible temple that passes through the fires and then becomes fully consummated in the physical heavens and earth. But one could read my book and take it in a postmillennial way, I suppose, but I don't take it in that way. May the church of the 21st century unite in order to attain this goal. Then may the church, the true Israel and true temple, experience the priestly blessing pronounced on Israel from the tabernacle as it extends God's tabernacling presence. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance on you. And what's the last part? And give you peace. All right, well, we're going to have to finish. What I'd like to do, though, at the beginning of the question and answer, if it's okay, I have a hymn about the temple. And I just wanted to read the words of the hymn at some point during question and answer, because I fear that I'm about to be cast off.